Fine. Good afternoon, everyone. Hope you are all doing fine. And so my name is Venkatesh, as Sai Suma explained. So I have more than 10 years of experience in the power electronics industry and more on the design. So today I would like to take you to the brief introduction on the aspects of the industrial converter designs using power electronics. So I move on to the contents of this PPT. So I'll start with the introduction to the power electronics. And why and where do we use the power electronics, and what is power electronics? First of all, we'll start with that, and then why do we use the power electronics? Content slide, Saisuma. Yeah, we'll start with the introduction, and then we'll go with type of converters. Then, what are the different types of converters? And next, so we'll see elements of the power converter, and then few applications also we'll see. Is there a delay? Yeah, few applications we'll see it, and then we'll see the introduction to the converter switch mainly. In the academics, basically, you might have come across the diode and thyristors and the GTOs, of course. So academics are restricted to that. But in the industry, mainly we use MOSFETs, IGBTs. And going forward, we are also using now silicon carbide and gallium nitride and many more wideband gap materials in the future. Let us see. So here we introduce the switch, IGBT. Let's see the characteristics, static as well as the dynamic characteristics. And we'll see the different manufacturers of the IGBT. And we'll also see the role of power electronics in e-vehicle. You all know e-vehicle is a trending in future, and which is the future also. So we'll see what is the role of power electronics, and then what type of converters do we use in e-vehicle. So one such example is the onboard charger, of course. And we'll see the typical block diagram of it. And finally, what do you have as a hardware designer? So what inputs do you get? And this is just a brief, of course, from the customers. Usually we get the 200 to 300 page document, but we will see just a brief or a glimpse of it. What main inputs are there for the hardware designer? We will see the trends in this field, evolution, how is going on, how is evolving in future, and then what is the direction we'll see. And for you, what is the entry point and what are the job opportunities? Suppose if you enter as a fresher or a designer, and how your career path moves ahead. We will see that. And then finally, in this PPT, so I would like to end with the references of where I have taken for this PPT. Okay, so let's good to go. So we'll start with the first one. So introduction to the power electronics. Can you move to the next slide? Yeah. Yes, the main task of the power electronics is to convert one form of electrical energy to the another form. Basically, the other form or the output is the controlled one, or the current, which is also a controlled one, or both can be controlled at a time as desired by the load. So this is the one. So here shows the typical example or typical simple diagram of the power electronic converter. I have not shown anything here, the feedbacks or the control of nothing. It is this simple converter and the power input and the power output here, right? So this is how the block diagram of the converter, the simple converter look like. The main objective or the basic objective is, what is the objective? Can you tell me? It is not just to reduce the size or the weight or the cost, nor the cost. But the main important factor is the efficiency or the losses. So we desire the loss of this converter to be very less when we are designing this converter. So that is the main objective, apart from the size and weight or the cost. Those are also important factors. Let us see now. So this is about the power electronics. It is to convert one form of electrical energy to the other form. Just remember that. The other form, the load output is a controlled voltage or the controlled current, or it can be both controlled. Let's move to the next slide. So we'll see why do we need it. First of all, the power electronics, why don't we have any other thing? So we'll take a simple circuit here. I say this circuit can be realized by the power electronic converter, right? But forget about the power electronic DC-DC converter in the middle of this block diagram. Right. How can you implement this circuit? How do you realize this circuit or the converter? Can you tell me? See, the input here is the 200 volts. And we need 1 kilowatt output here. So for example, I need 100 volt load here and 10 ampere output I need for this load. So how do you realize this power, this converter or this circuit? It's pretty simple. One way is to look at, suppose say for example, I need the 10 ampere load current. One way to look at is use a simple resistor here. Can you please move to the next slide? So I can keep a simple resistor here, 10 ohms, so that 200 divided by this 10 plus 10, 10 ampere might flow through this circuit, this series circuit. And then the power loss here is 1 kilowatt. Obviously, I get the power output as 1 kilowatt. What is important here is you must note, I should supply the input power as a 2 kilowatt. Please note this point to get the output power of 1 kilowatt, whereas the loss here is the 1 kilowatt. So half of my power is being wasted in the resistor in the form of a loss or the heat, right? So this is a variable resistor here as shown in this picture, but of course I have maintained here it as a 10 ohm. Let's see. Let's see what are the other options where I can realize this circuit. Do I have any method to reduce this loss? Do you have anything to reduce this loss? Do you have any other options? Yes, this is one more method here, previous one. This is a one more method here. Here, there's a transistor here. This transistor operates in active region. This is 100 volt, not 50 volt here. See here, this transistor operates in active region, which is nothing but the same as a resistor divider, which is no big different than a resistor, which dissipates a huge power, of course. It's approximately 1 kilowatt. But here, the transistor needs a base drive. So we take the reference from the output of this transistor, the current, and then we provide the base drive somehow. But the transistor still operates in the active region, so which is of no use, which is also the loss is approximately 1 kilowatt. So do we have a better method? Yes, we do have the better method. Yes, this is a better method. Say, for example, you have the switch here. I'm using here SPDT switch. And this SPDT switch is nothing but a double throw. You have a single pole here. It's nothing but a single pole double throw. And say, for example, the switch is at the position one now. So you will get the same input as output. Say, for example, this is a connected. Assume the wire is shown disconnected here. Say this is a connected one. Assume that is a connected one. Now the switch is position one. And then you the output will be reflected as input voltage. When the switch is position two, since the switch voltage, say for example, is negligible, the output will be reflected as a negligible voltage, which is of course the switch voltage. If I say the timing is, the switch is closed at the position one for DTS, where D is the duty cycle. If I say that for a DTS period, the output voltage is VZ, I can say for 1 minus DTS period, the output voltage is negligible, which is switch voltage. For ideal case, it is 0 and VZ, but in the practical case, it's not a VZ, it is VZ minus the switch voltage. And it's not a 0, of course, during 1 minus DTS period, it is approximately the switch voltage, slightly higher than the 0. Here, what I just did, now you have the output voltage VG, which switches between the VG and zero. What if you have implemented the low pass filter, LNC? Yes, obviously you get the average voltage. You can get the average voltage if you properly design it, such that the filter frequency is much more or less than the switching frequency, right? So you get the average voltage here. You get the desired voltage as the output because it is oscillating between the VG as well as zero, where VG is the 200 volts and zero. What is the average voltage here? 200 and zero. Suppose you are switching at 0.5 50% duty cycle, then you will get 100 volt at the output. If you are using the LC filter properly designed such that the frequency is lesser than the switching frequency, much lesser than the switching frequency. Here, one thing to note here, very important point. That is the objective here. What is that? The loss is very small. The losses are very small. How? Because during when switch is closed, the switch voltage is a negligible voltage. At any point of time, you have a switch closed. Approximately, you have a negligible voltage across the switch. So the switch loss or this converter loss is approximately zero. I cannot say zero because in a practical case, we have a more switching losses as well as conduction losses. That we discuss when we are discussing more about the switches, right? So this LNC are not lossy elements, ideally, but practically they are also lossy elements. There are ESR and approximately for both LNC values. So say for example, at present the circuit is ideal. LNC are not lossy elements. These are just energy storage elements. The energy will be stored and will be delivered as and when required. Right. The switches are ideal. So the switches are less losses here, for example, now the power loss is so small. So for 1 kilowatt output, you approximately need a 1 kilowatt input or a slightly higher than that, not the 2 kilowatt as we saw in the previous examples. Now, this is a summary. So suppose, say, for example, now the switch is closing for DTS period, and the switch is closing at the second throw for a 1 minus DTS period, right? Now, the average component is, you all know the average how to calculate. So the TS times the VS of T, so which is nothing but the DVZ. If you find out the average of this one, 1 by TS, integral of 0 to TS VS of T, which is nothing but DVZ, right? So this is the average value. Of course, this average value we can realize if we properly design the LNC. Remember this point. Yeah, someone has asked the question. So how can we give the DC to the inductor? See, we are not getting the pure DC before the inductor. It is a switched DC, or it's a still AC, I can say. But only after this LNC values, you get the average value. So the designing, the magnetics is very important here. The designing LNC, for the switched DC is very important. The magnetics is a separate subject, and so it needs very basic understanding of high frequency subject. Now, coming to this, why high efficiency is necessary? Now see, this graph shows the loss divided by output versus efficiency. Now you can see easily from this graph, say for example, the loss divided by output is zero, means the approximately the loss is zero. The efficiency obviously you get it is very high. It is nearly one or equal to one. Now, when the loss by output ratio is increasing, the efficiency slightly tend to decrease. So now what is the point here to note down? So the efficiency is related to the loss of this converter. So when you need high efficiency, obviously you need a low loss, or the vice versa. When you have a lower loss, you will have the higher efficiency. The other way I can say, if efficiency is higher, the supply requirements can be much smaller, right? If size is smaller for a given power output, operation is much more reliable, and then cost can be reduced. If requirements, power supply requirements are lesser, and then your power module or the power converter, the switch can be of lesser size, so and so. Right? There are many other advantages which we will discuss while going detailed into the subject. Of course, not in this PPT, but maybe. Now, what is a converter? So this is a typical converter we have seen so far. I say this is a switching converter. So in the first examples, we have just shown the converter, but now we understood the importance of the switching converter here. Now the switching converter, we must give the power input as well as the power output. It will deliver the power output is desired by the loads. But apart from this, we don't get power output as it is. But for this switching converter, we need a control input here. That is one thing. So we'll discuss for what is the control input there. Now the switching converter can be of many types. I mean, basically four types. Can be many also. There are many converters evolving. So basically these four types are the origin of the other converters. The DC-DC converter, which is nothing but the input is a DC, and we get the control DC output or the volt control DC voltage or the current, which or whatever. Mainly this DC-DC converter can be, we can see this in the power supplies, like the computer power supply, or in any vehicle, if you see the electric vehicle, if you see the onboard charger, which we are going to see the block diagram in very soon. And a rectifier, which is nothing but the AC input voltage to the DC output. Of course, you might have studied, I mean, phase control ones in the academics, but this rectifier uses converters, which is nothing but the AC input voltage is required, so which can also give the DC output. This rectifier we use to control the line current, basically to shape the line current, which is in phase with the line voltage. The purpose of this switching rectifier is to control or shape the line current. And the inverter, which we will see in powertrains, basically the electric vehicle or a drives or wherever. So control control output AC voltage and the frequency also can be controlled in the inverter. The cycle converters which need the AC input and the AC output, of course, both voltages and frequency can be controlled. So these are the four switching converters. We will see it. This is a converter, and these are the four basic types of a switching converter. And just shortly, we have seen we need a control input. We need a control input. Why do we need a control input? Power input and power output. Generally, feedback is invariably required. We must need the feedback to get the desired power output. So this feedback, along with the reference, can provide the control input or the duty cycle to the switching converter. In the previous slide, you have seen the switching, the SPDT switch is at the position one and the position two. But what is the input there? Of course, the power, one is the power input, the main circuit. But you have to throw the switch at position one and the position two. So you need the control input to this switch to throw it from one point to another point, right? So that is nothing but the control input. So that control input is from the controller, which takes the feedback from the power output or the output voltage, basically, right? So this output voltage is compared with the reference voltage and provides the error signal. The error signal is nothing but the control input, which is provided as a duty cycle to the switching converter. And in some cases, we also use the feed forward to compare the current. Both voltage and current can be compared with using this controller to provide the control input. So we'll see, more of this design will come when we are going into deep into circuits. That time will come to this. These are basic picture of the switching converter, so which needs a controller also. And a reference is required to this controller. And control input can be provided by comparing this feedback and reference. Just remember this. These are the basic elements of the power converter. Of course, you all must be knowing it. There is no need of a big introduction here. The resistors, capacitors, nothing. This power converter is nothing but the resistors, capacitors, magnetics, linear mode, and switch mode. You must note the magnetics we are not using to derive the control signal because it introduces delays. For signal processing, we don't use the magnetics, major magnetics. Of course, we use a simple magnetic maybe, but it introduces a larger delays if you use a bigger magnetic. And linear mode devices and resistors, we don't use for the power processing. We have already seen this. One we use in the resistor, one example, and another one we use in the linear mode device, the transistor which operates in the active region. Both are lossy, so we don't use during the main input path, and we don't use the magnetics in the control input path. Just remember these things. Otherwise, these are the devices or these are the elements we use in the power converter. Yes, these are typical example of a power converter. So as I have shown in the previous slide, just a block diagram. Now see here, of course, I forgot to mention you, this converter is the converter which we have shown in the example is the buck converter, and the same converter is shown here. This is a single pole, this is a SPDT switch. The one switch is in the form of a MOSFET here, the other switch is in the form of a diode here. And one switch, suppose now the load voltage is compared with sensor, and sensor gain can be given the compensator by comparing the reference input. And then this compensator can provide the control input voltage, which in turn gives the duty cycle by the pulse width modulator. Right. So this duty cycle can be given to the MOSFET or a IGBT, whatever it is. So this is a control path, H of S, G of GC of S, and then this pulse width modulator and the transistor gate driver. So this is nothing but a control path. And the power path is the VG switch, and then this diode, and then LC, and of course the load is what you put there. Right. So this is the basic typical example of a power converter with the feedbacks shown in the block diagram. So move to the next slide. And these are the few typical example of a laptop computer power supply. Yeah, this is a laptop computer power supply. So here, the AC line input is what we have in the AC, usually 230 volt AC. So 230 volt AC, and then we put here a PWM rectifier. Of course, the purpose of this rectifier or a PWM rectifier is to shape this input current IAC of T, which is depicted in the. And then this rectifier output is of course a DC. And of course, generally you need a bulk caps across this DC. Usually this DC here is a lithium battery. If a battery is very strict, although we provide a small amount of caps there. So, and then this lithium battery, and then this is a DC. So you have a various loads in the computer power supply. one, you need a supply for a display backlighting. You need a supply for a microprocessor, which is in the computer, and you also have a lot of ICs, power management ICs, in the computer. You need a supply there, and you also need a supply for your hard disk. So there are the different requirements for the display battery backlighting. So you need AC voltage, of course. You need an inverter, the switching inverter for the display backlighting. And so this DC from the lithium battery is converted to the AC by this inverter. And then for other requirements for microprocessor and power management, you use a buck converter. And then for disk drives, you need a higher voltage, so you'll use a boost converter there, which is a DC-DC converter again. So this is a typical block diagram of the laptop computer power supply. So we'll see another example, another application. This is the electric vehicle power and drivetrain. Here we have seen shown many missions, many AC missions. But in general, there can be two missions, front and back, in the electric vehicle. Although it can be many also. There are four AC missions. The battery can be charged by the AC supply, so which is a grid voltage. The battery can be charged. So here, the battery charger is again a power electronic converter. Remember this point. This is a DC-DC converter, this battery charger. So it will be charged. This DC-DC converter will charge the battery from the AC. And the inverters again will run the main. And if there are any other supplies that we require, because there is a microcontroller, microprocessor, microcontroller, the system controller, and then vehicle electronics requires a lot of power supplies. And we use the DC-DC converter, auxiliary DC-DC converter, to supply the. So one important interesting point about this battery charger is, this battery charger can be charged two modes. One is, we'll discuss more about the onboard charger here. Onboard charger, which takes the AC. So we will have an input PWM rectifier there, or a diode rectifier, which can also be possible. And we need a PFC here in between. And we will have a DC-DC converter here in the battery charger. So this battery charger is a DC-DC converter, or AC-DC converter, I can say, sorry, AC-DC converter. So which takes the AC input, and which has a rectifier inside, which has the PFC part or the boost converter inside, and which also has the DC-DC converter inside this battery charger. So we'll see that. I have the block diagram of this in this PPT also. Now we have seen the basic typical block diagrams of the converters, and then how it looks like the feedback, and then the main how it looks the feedback. So we will not see the design aspects in this PPT. We'll just have an overview of it. Now about the converter switch also, we'll have some overview. So what is the converter switch? So this converter switch, you already saw in the previous slide, it can be a MOSFET, right? Which usually have the low losses, including both switching and the conduction period. And of course, that's resulting in the high. Now, which type of converter switches do we use here? Power semiconductors, you already seen that, MOSFET as well as IGBTs. But the trend that is going towards is silicon carbide or the wide band gap materials, which are this, also gallium nitride for low power. Silicon carbide generally we use for high power applications and then high voltage applications. Gallium nitride for a low voltage application. See more about this converter switch now. Just introduction of this converter switch. So the switches generally we use in the power electronics are the two switches, IGBT as well as the MOSFET, basically in the current scenario. Although we use the silicon carbide ones, but that is still in the research in some phase. But widely we are using IGBTs and MOSFETs. Both are three terminal device, but what is the difference? You can see the difference easily from the pictures. The MOSFET is not having this P plus layer, you can see that. But whereas the IGBT is having, which helps in blocking the high voltage. So this P plus layer and N minus, this slightly doped in between, so which can block the high voltage. The IGBT is basically can be used for the high voltages, whereas the MOSFET cannot block high voltages. So the IGBT shown here in the picture is NPT or planar type. There are different types where the gate can be trench. Trench means it's a through hole. Gate can be big. There are vertical structures. There is planar technology. There are a lot of structures in the IGBT. There are a lot of technologies. There's a field stop technology and CST beta technology. There are a lot of terminology used by the manufacturers. We will see that when we, maybe in the future PPTs. Now, both, one thing you need to observe here, the gate is isolated from the layers. through the insulation layer or mainly silicon oxide. So the IGBT or the MOSFET, both can be controlled by giving the by controlling the voltage between the gate and emitter or between the gate and source. Right. The three terminals in the MOSFET, drain, gate and source, and the three terminal in the IGBT or collector, gate and emitter. So please move to the next slide. These are the static characteristics of this IGBT. You have three states, basically the forward blocking. You have a saturation as well, and you have an active region as well. So these are three states in the IGBT, and there is, in the reverse quadrant, so you'll have the diode characteristics, basically. One is with diode, IGBT with hybrid diode. The one is, of course, without diode, I'm sorry. The one is without any diode. So it is breaking down with only IGBT. One thing to note, if you apply the VCE, means the voltage across the collector and emitter of the IGBT, the IGBT keeps blocking the voltage, even if the gate voltage is lesser. So the IGBT will not be turning on unless you apply the gate voltage greater than the threshold voltage of the gate. As long as you apply the lower gate voltage below the threshold voltage of the gate, the IGBT will not be turned on. It is in the forward blocking. And then as you keep on increasing collector voltage, it still blocks it. It will break down at some point. So that is a breakdown voltage of the IGBT. That is called avalanche breakdown. And here is a one interesting factor. If you need to operate the IGBT as a switch, we must need to operate the IGBT in the saturation region. So the saturation voltage, saturation region is nothing but the voltage and current, which can be increased linearly, but provided you must apply the gate voltage above the threshold voltage. So usually the manufacturers recommend the 15 volt gate voltage for a turning on and -8 for turning off. Of course, zero can be provided to turn off the gate voltage. To make sure it is completely turned off, -8 is recommended. We will see that in practical aspects in coming. I think somebody is having a question here. Someone is having a question. So open, Shrike.
Mr. Venkatesh, we can take up the questions at the end of the session. We request you to proceed further.
Right, fine. Yeah. Okay. Yes, this is the one thing. So forward blocking characteristics, which is nothing but the IGBT blocks the voltage, which the IGBT doesn't conduct. And the losses are also negligible here because there is very low current that is flowing to the IGBT during the blocking state. You can see from the graph as well. Right. In the saturation region, very interesting. The IGBT is turned on, means the switch is closed, but the voltage is negligible. When the switch is closed, the voltage is negligible, but the current keeps building up, provided the gate voltage is greater than threshold voltage. That is one important point. So here in the saturation region also, the loss is negligible. Of course, I can say it is negligible at this point of time because it is not. We have not discussed yet the losses which is. So, but there are losses during the on state, during the saturation region. The drop across the IGBT or the switch is very small. It is not a zero, as we discussed earlier, as ideal, it is not zero, right?